Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to our Sunday service. Today is last Sunday of May, May 30th, and praise God. Yeah, we again survive another month of, through God's faithfulness, through God's mercy and compassion towards us. Today is the day the Lord's made, and let us rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. As always, this Sunday is a special day of the Lord, and let's put our hearts together in praising and worshiping God. Of course, be ready to receive what God has in store for us. We have a very special speaker today, but before we proceed with our service, let me call my son Daniel to open up in prayer.
Good morning, everyone. How's everyone this morning? Give a thumbs up if you're good. You're blessed. Nice. What I like to see. I was out on my morning run this morning, and it was a beautiful day out. I noticed it was, since it's a nice chill but still sunny day out, so I think that's my perfect day out. I don't know about you. Who here got to spend some time outside this morning? Raise your hand. Yeah, a little bit of time. That's good. If you haven't yet, I hope you get some time to spend outside. It's soak up the sun, enjoy God's blessing and creation. I think it's the time to do that now. So before we begin, why don't we just pray together this morning and prepare for what God has for us this morning. Lord, thank you for this beautiful Sunday morning. Thank you for the nice chill air you've given us, and the beautiful sun that's out warming us up. Thank you that we can experience those blessings each and every day. Thank you that we are here together over Zoom to worship and spend time in your word together. Although we're not physically in the same space, we know that you're here with each and every one of us in our own homes, guiding us, protecting us, shielding us. We thank you for that, Lord. I pray for your special anointing over this meeting, from the worship to the word to everyone listening here. I pray that you open our hearts so that we may hear your word and hear your love through those words. Transform us, mold us today. We love you, Lord God, and thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Daniel, for opening up in prayer. Before we proceed to our worship, I'm asking Kamei to show on the screen what we have in store for the coming week. So, Kamei. So, our week begins on Wednesday. That will be June the 2nd, wherein we got it together during our midweek service. And at 7 p.m., and our exhorter will be my wife, Sister Resi. And if you have any prayer requests, please call, text, or email myself, Pastor Mike, or Sister Resi. And definitely we will include your prayer requests into our list. And just so you know, like I've been sharing Sunday after Sunday, we've been experiencing a lot of miracles, a lot of answered prayers during the midweek. And so if you are free, please join us so that we can pray together, we can hear the word of God together, and worship God together. And so on Sunday service, of course, that will be June the 6th, first Sunday of the month. Praise God. Worship leader will be my son, Daniel, and I will be preaching God's word and closing also the service. And with regards to giving, again, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you for your faithful giving, for your faithful sacrificial offering to the works of God through BLF Christian Fellowship. And there are three ways how you can support this ministry. Number one, through online using Tithely apps through your phone or your laptop. Or you can still do the traditional writing a check, and you can either drop off the check to Sister Tess David, our treasurer, or call her so she can arrange to pick up the check from your house. So be ready and be excited to what God has for us today. And I'm calling Tofi and Kyla, brothers and sisters, to lead us in worship today.
Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's had a blessed week and is so full of love and full of joy, no matter what the circumstances are around us. So as we worship today, let's dig deep into our hearts and just ask God to continuously mold us and help us be strong and courageous during these difficult times. For, you know, he rises and he never falls, no matter what happens. Amen. So let's just find strength in him. Let's just surrender this day and for the rest of our lives to him. wonderful, marvelous, forever beautiful, Prince of Peace, faithful one.
Hallelujah, Lord. You are the ever-living God, wonderful, beautiful, powerful, compassionate, loving, oh God, Lord, merciful, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. You're the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, oh God, Lord. And we praise you. We praise you. We glorify you. We magnify your name. We lift up your name on high, oh Jesus, oh God, Lord. Hallelujah. You're the only one who's deserving of our praises, our thanksgiving, our adoration, our exaltation. Holy Spirit, take over now, O God, Lord, in our service today, O God, Lord. Hallelujah. We give you glory, honor, and praise. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Praise God. Thank you, Tolfa and Kyla, for leading us into this wonderful, wonderful worship unto our God. And again, welcome everybody to all of you just tune in our Zoom service. Praise God. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. God, there's so much in store for us today, and I'm very excited. I hope you're excited too. And of course, as I said earlier, we are blessed and honored to have Pastor Mark Collin visiting us and gracing our celebration by his presence, of course, being that he will be God's mouthpiece today. Praise God. So before I call in Pastor Mark, let me just give you a little bit of information or introduction regarding our dear friend, Pastor Mark Collin. Pastor Mark Collin is a passionate follower of Jesus Christ, as we can see that. He has been happily married to Wendy for, listen to this, 44 years. Wow. I think you got married when you were 12. You don't look very, very, you look very young to be married for 44 years. Pastor Mark and Sister Wendy are blessed parents of three children, Nathan, Reverend Skip Collin, married to his wife, Reverend Jessica, Patrick and Elise, and they are proud grandparents of Kennedy Collins, Summer Collins, Maxwell, and Anderson, four grandchildren. Pastor Mark and Wendy live in Vineland Station, Ontario, Canada, where they like to sail, cycle, surf, and go for very short walks on the beach. Pastor Mark currently catalyzes the regenerate approach in the Western Ontario District of the PAOC, where his role is to evaluate, develop, and deploy revisioning strategies for worshiping communities. He also serves as a church tactical consultant to many churches and denominations across Canada. They have benefited from his experience and approaches. His goal is motivating leaders and churches to optimize and implement the resources that God has given them. Before I call in Pastor Mark, I'd like to share to you a very, very wonderful story. While I was cleaning up my office maybe a few weeks ago, I came across this bag of barley in one of my drawer. If you've been, if you remember the last time Pastor Mark was here, he was carrying a full sack of barley. Okay, so during that preaching, he used this sack of barley as his illustration, and he preached on Ruth chapter one. Now, of course, he's speaking about the story of Ruth and Naomi. And I remember this, the title of his preaching is A Story of Destiny. And then he said this, that we are being full to be emptied, and we are being emptied to be filled again. See, I remember that because I was taking notes, not because I have good memory though, okay? And he came to our church as a guest speaker to our 6th year anniversary, March 4th of 2018. Now, for 2018. Now, what did I write on that bag of barley? Because Pastor Mark challenged us that our harvest is coming. We need to pray for the harvest of the Lord in our life. And so he gave us a bag and said, grab some barley, put in your bag, and write whatever you are praying to God as your harvest. And I grabbed a bag, filled it up with barley, and wrote something in it. Guess what I wrote in there? This is what I wrote. I wrote in that barley bag, Lord, I want my wife to retire early from her job so that she can be full-time in helping me in the ministry. That was March 4, 2018. Guess what? August of 2018. My wife retired from her job at age of 56, and she's now helping me in the ministry and taking care also of our grandkids. Isn't it that God is good?
Amen.
God is good. He is so good. Like I said, I thought God is a way of reminding me things. He let me found this bag of barley just in time for Pastor Mark Colin coming to preach to our church today. Mm-hmm. And so I thought share it with you, and because I thought it's very encouraging. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Pastor Mark Collins.
Thank you, Pastor Rick. It's an honor to be here with you today. I feel like I'm part of your family, and I remember the day that it was my daughter's wedding, and we were in Niagara on the Lake, and I looked in the park, and there was Rick and his wife and all of you having a picnic, and I thought, well, this is part of my family. So that was a great day that day. Today, I'm glad Pastor Rick talked a little bit about the barley, because that talks about growth and about fruitfulness and what God wants to do. Today, I want to talk to you about a mystery. Show me by hands, how many of you like a mystery? You like a mystery story, a mystery, you watch the mystery movies. I want to talk today about the mystery of thorns. Now, spring is here, and all the flowers and the vegetables and the fruits are beginning to grow. I live in Vineland, and everything is growing like your gardens are beginning to bloom, and the trees will soon begin to yield fruit. I saw yesterday there's fresh strawberries in Vineland, and the season is going to become rich with color and beauty. And some of you are gardeners, and maybe I could ask you this morning, what are you growing in your garden? Maybe you're growing some peppers or some tomatoes, or maybe it's flowers, roses, or trees. And I'm sure many of you are growing in your lawn weeds and thorns. You see, experience teaches us that love of fruit and flowers is not enough to make you a good gardener. You've got to learn to live with the weeds, and you have to learn to live with the thorns. Now, you've probably also noticed that we live in a fallen and a very sinful world. How many have noticed? We live in a sinful world. That's the truth. You see, nothing is perfect. And isn't it funny how we want everything to be perfect? We demand perfection. When we go to the grocery store, we try to pick the perfect fruit. Now, have you ever noticed where the thorns grow? If I look out my window, the thorns are in my front lawn. The thorns are in the field. The thorns and the weeds are in your garden. They're everywhere. The thorns are everywhere. the seeds of thorns have been scattered. And the Bible says that the wheat and the thorns will grow together. You can't get rid of them. God causes them both to grow. And you and I live in a fallen world where there's weeds. Now, why do we live in a fallen world? God, you remember the story in the Garden of Eden, and Adam and Eve eat from the fruit that they weren't supposed to eat from. And God said to Adam, because you listened to your wife and ate the fruit from the tree which I commanded you must not eat from, cursed is the ground. Because of you, through painful toil, you will eat food from it all the days of your life. Now, it will produce, this is what God says, it will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the dust. This is God's promise to us, because we were taken from dust, and he says, to dust we will return. The earth will produce thorns. That's the truth. Now, the hard thing that we have a problem with is, again, I said, we want perfection. And Jesus even says, when he's on the earth, he says, in this world, you will have problems. How many have had some problems? We have problems. All of us have these thorns in our life. And those thorns can be from the past. Maybe something happened when we were younger. It might be a thorn of a memory. Maybe that thorn is a current sickness that's plaguing you, or a plague that is sickening you. Or perhaps it's some other thing that's happening in your life, and it's a thorn. Maybe it's some type of failure. Maybe you failed in a relationship or felt you had a relationship go wrong. Or maybe that thorn is an attitude that you just can't seem to conquer. And it continues to grow in your life. You see, as followers of Jesus, we love to celebrate the resurrection. We want to celebrate the victory over death that Christ has conquered for every one of us. But you know what? We get really uncomfortable with Good Friday. Because Good Friday speaks of suffering. It speaks of pain. It speaks of toil and agony and sacrifice. Now, we've entered into a new season. Throughout this pandemic, things have changed in our world. But I want to make a very bold statement today. As a Christ follower, this is my Christ follower confession. Maybe you want to write this down. As Christ followers, we must recognize that we need to be thankful for the thorns in our life. Yes, that's what I said. As Christ followers, we need to be thankful for the thorns. Well, why should we be thankful for the thorns? Many of you are sitting there saying, why did this thorn happen to me? How come it didn't happen to him or to her or to that family? Why is that happening to me? And instead of asking the why me question, I think we need to ask ourselves, why not? You see, because that's the mystery of the thorns. God is not primarily concerned about my comfort. God is concerned about my character. He's not concerned about your comfort. He's concerned about your character. We will have all of eternity to be comfortable with Jesus. With him, with the saints, glorifying God. And every day, folks, we are moving closer, one step closer to eternity every day. We move one step closer to eternity and one step farther away from this world. You understand? Today, we move one step closer to eternity, one step further away from this world. We're closer to Jesus today than we have ever been. Don't cling to this world. Today, we're going to see just how God accomplishes great things in our life using thorns. So let's start with the first thing. In the Old Testament, Ezekiel the prophet, he says, don't be afraid though briars and thorns are all around you and you live among scorpions. Wow. Don't be afraid. Now listen, it says, remember God said, the thorns are going to come. They're going to be around us. Jesus said, in this life, you will have problems. But Ezekiel, the Old Testament prophet, says, even though the thorns are all around you and even scorpions, don't be afraid. That's very easy to say, but it's harder to do. The first thing you need to learn about thorns is not to fear them. Now, you can't ignore them because they'll poke you when they hurt, but you have to learn not to fear them. The reason I say that is because God has said to us, he's not given us the spirit of fear. Rather, he's given us the spirit of power, the spirit of love, a spirit of a sound mind. Many times when people are experiencing very difficult situations, they've said, Pastor Mark, I feel like this thorn is causing me to lose my mind. And I say, no, that's the enemy speaking. The enemy is coming to destroy. And the enemy cannot destroy you through a thorn. The enemy is aiming for your mind. And if it's a thorn that's poking us somewhere in our life, we can say, no, I'm not going to fear that thorn. It's only a thorn. Now, I want to talk today a little bit about the things that thorns can produce in our lives, because thorns actually, they can be beneficial to us. I've learned this over the years, over my years of life, Pastor Rick said, many years of life. I've learned what thorns can do. The first thing that I've learned about thorns is thorns produce humility. Thorns produce humility. Have you noticed that suddenly when there's a thorn in our life, we become more sensitive to God? We become more sensitive to other people. We regard other people higher than ourselves because suddenly we realize that person has I have a thorn. Maybe they have the same issue or the same problem. Thorns cause us to be vulnerable. I remember one time when I was early in ministry, you know, at the end of a sermon, I would preach and I would call people for prayer. And many times people would come and they would say, oh, Pastor, will you pray for me? I have a terrible headache. And I would say, yeah, okay. You see, I'd never had a headache. And I thought, how can your head ache? I don't see a headache. It doesn't look like you're in pain. And I would pray, oh, Jesus, help them with their headache. Go away. You know, I wasn't very nice. And then I woke up one night in the middle of the night and I thought somebody parked a truck on my head. And my head was pounding and it was so sore. And I said to my wife, something's wrong with my head. She goes, well, you have a headache. I said, this is awful. This feels terrible. She goes, yeah, that's how people feel when they have a headache. And I went through a whole season of my life where I had headaches. I had migraine headaches. I had to sit in a dark room with a pillow over my head because I was in so much pain. That thorn of that headache was poking me in the head. Do you know what happened? The next time I called people for prayer, And a lady came and said, Pastor Mark, will you pray for my headache? I hugged her. I said, oh, my dear, I want to pray for your headache. I know what this headache feels like. You see, thorns make us vulnerable. They cause us to be humble. The reason we hate thorns is because they humble us. We want to stand on a pedestal, but the thorn humbles us. The thorn drives us to humility. It causes us to be humble. Now, what's the benefit of that? Let me tell you. Do you know what God says? You know, have you ever prayed and you've prayed and you've prayed and prayed and it seems like God doesn't answer your prayer? God says that if we will humble ourselves and pray, he will hear us. Now, what does the thorn do? the thorn humbles us. Now we're humble. If we humble ourselves and pray, the Bible says God will hear us. I want God to be able to hear me when I pray. Could it be that the thorn is there to heal you so that you can pray with humility? What's the second thing? The second thing is thorns purify our motives. When there's thorns in our lives, we quickly recognize what things in life are really trivial and really petty and really silly. And suddenly we realize what is really, really important. Have you had to recalibrate a lot of things during this pandemic? See, when we weren't in a pandemic, when there wasn't a thorn or a plague in our life, everything was okay, don't worry, do this, do that, go here, go there. Suddenly, new Gucci jeans, a new purse, a new car, suddenly all of that doesn't matter because we've recalibrated everything in our lives. Our motives have become pure. God uses the fire of the Holy Spirit to burn away all the impure motives in our lives. That's what thorns do. They help us to purify our motives. What else do thorns do? Thorns push us. They prompt us to believe. Sometimes we have doubts about our faith in Jesus. Sometimes we're not sure whether we should trust God or not. Can we really, really trust us? Can we really trust God? But when there's a thorn in our life, have you ever found this? When there's a thorn in your life, you suddenly decide that you would not choose to suffer. When I have a thorn in my life, I'm like, I don't like suffering. This isn't fun. And I don't want to suffer in my life. How much less do I want to suffer for someone else? But Christ chose to suffer, not for anything that he did. Christ did not deserve the anguish. He didn't deserve to suffer, but he did it for you. He took your crown of thorns and he allowed that crown to pierce his head. He gave himself in your place. Thorns prompt us to belief. Let me talk about why did Jesus die? What's that about? It's really about a man dying on the cross for the sins of the world to give us life. Remember, the truth is, the whole reason we follow Christ is because he loved us first. We didn't love him. He found us. People sometimes say, oh, well, I found Jesus. No, you didn't. He found you. He was looking for you. He searched for you. He hunted you down. And that's why we take time to worship. Earlier in our service today, we took time to worship. Why do we worship? Because we worship the one who hunted us down, who found us. He found us. We were lost sheep. We were caught in the thorns of life. And he said, no, come and follow me. Maybe I'll talk about the fourth thing that thorns do. The fourth things that thorns do is they help us to realize that God loves us enough to say yes and no. Thorns prod us closer to God. You see, you can tell how much a parent loves a child by their ability to say yes and no. There's an interesting story in the Old Testament. You know the story. It's Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the three Hebrew boys. And they were told that if they didn't bow down to the king, they were going to go through a fire, literally a fire. And they could have relented. They could have said, no, listen. Okay, God, listen, we're just going to bow down to this king. We kind of still love you, but we're going to bow down to the king and we don't have to go through this fire. But they didn't walk away from God. It's funny the things, and as you get older, you realize the strange little petty things that people walk away from God for. The little struggles, the little pains, the little temptations. But these three boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were unfaltering in their trust. They knew they were going to go through a fire, a difficult, difficult time. But the three of them stood and they said this to the king, "But know this, O king, even if God doesn't save us, we will not bow down to you. We will not forsake the God of Israel." Notice, they still go through the fire. We would think, oh, well, God's going to reach in and like a superhero and pull them out of this and rescue them. No, God allows them to go through that because he wanted to purify them. He wanted to prepare them, because what happens after that is a great moment in the history of Israel. Now, sometimes the thorn may not ever be removed. This is a hard thing for me to say. There are times in our life when the thorn will not be removed. But I want to say this to you today, that God has promised us wisdom, courage, and strength in those moments. God's promised us that. He said, "I will give you wisdom, power, and strength." The Apostle Paul said this, "In order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times," he says, "I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but God said, 'My grace is sufficient for you. My power is made perfect in weakness.' Ooh. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. This is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in my weakness." I delight, Paul says, in my thorn, in insults, in hardship, in persecution, in difficulty. "For when I am weak, then I am strong." In your house, I want you to say that, because you're with your family, you're with your loved one. I want you to turn to your children and say, "When we are weak, then we are strong, because God strengthens us." You see, when we make that declaration, I want you to know that the darkness trembles. The darkness trembles at that light. When we declare to the enemy that when we are weak, then in Christ we are strong, the enemy has to flee from us. So you're asking me, how do we resolve the mystery? How do we come to some peace about it in our life? Let me say this. The first thing you do is stop asking yourself, "Why me?" Instead of asking, "Why me?", ask yourself this question: what now? What do I do now? In the midst of the storm, the thorn, what do I do? Well, the first thing you do is you learn to reduce your expectations. Now, this kind of goes against a lot of teaching today. The first step is to reduce your expectations. God says, "My grace is sufficient for you." My grace is sufficient. It's interesting. This word "sufficient" in the New Testament is written, and I don't know how you would translate it in Tagalog, but in English, or in Greek, the word is written in the present continuous state. That means it's good now and it's good forever. It's like sometimes in a contest on the TV, you can win a lifetime supply of Tim Hortons coffee. That's now and forever. That's what this means. Now and forever, God says, "I give you my sufficient grace." His grace is sufficient now and forever. That's what that means. Grace just isn't a one moment thing. It just doesn't happen for a second. It's now and forever. I get disappointed a lot of times with some of the Christian preaching I hear, that people say, "Well, God's kids, the children of God, go first." I got a newsflash for you. The Bible says that we're not to conform to the pattern of this world. We don't go around saying, "I deserve it." Instead, when we're transformed by the renewing of our minds, the Bible says we esteem other people as greater than ourselves. We say good things. We sacrifice for others, especially those who don't deserve it. That's a hard thing to do. Now, the second thing is, Remember that you can endure. Remember that you can endure. You have to recognize the difference between a storm and a thorn. Storms come and go. We had a storm 2 days ago. It came and it went. But thorns, they stick. Thorns get in and they grab a hold of you. And they're hard. They're very, very hard to get rid of you, to get rid of. You have to realize that other people have survived storms. Other people have survived thorns, and they've lived throughout difficult times in their life. There was a man in England. His name was Henry Light. I don't know if you have heard of Henry Light. He lived in the 17th century. He was born in a difficult situation. He suffered from asthma. He had bouts of coughing. He wanted to be a preacher. He had to take several jobs and work his way through college. He lived in a time when there was no health care, no free prescriptions, nothing like that. The aspirin had not been invented. He lived in constant pain. Yet Henry wanted to be a pastor, and he became a pastor, and he was not well, and his infant son passed away. And yet Henry kept enduring. He graduated from Trinity College in Ireland. And other people wrote, how does Pastor Henry continue on? How does he do it? Henry Light wrote a famous hymn. Some of you may know the hymn. You may have heard the words to this hymn. It's one of my favorite hymns. It's a great hymn of the church written over 300 years ago. The title of the hymn is Praise My Soul, the King of Heaven. Listen to these words. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven. To thy throne my tribute bring, ransomed, healed, restored, forgiven, evermore God's praises sing. Hallelujah, hallelujah, praise the everlasting King. Those are the words of a man who suffered over and over and over again. And yet Henry Light writes those words, praise my soul, the King of Heaven. I wonder if that in the middle of our suffering, in the middle of our thorn, we can just say, praise the Lord. That's why worship is so important. You have to understand that you are not alone in your suffering. That's why we gather as a family. That's why it's so important. As I sit here and I look at all of your faces, I think to myself, this is my family. This is part of God's family, and they won't let me suffer alone. Listen, I am so encouraged today that you already gave a report that though, although there's people back in the Philippines suffering, some need food, some need care, you are doing your best to care for them. You are not alone. When we have thorns, the best thing to know is we're not alone. Now, the third thing I will say is repent of escaping, of escaping, or escapism, maybe is the best word. Repent of escapism. Face your thorn. Recognize that in life, there's likely not a plan B. This is your life. Live it. You're going to have a thorn. Live your life profusely in Christ. Quit running away all the time. So many people, Christians I know, suddenly a thorn comes in their life, you know, and they run away. They things get difficult in their job, so they find another job, and they go to that job, and it's worse. You know, and I don't know about you, but I've seen some of my friends, you know, I've been married for 44 years. I'm not saying Wendy has been a thorn, but I know I've been a thorn to her, but she never ran away. I'm sure that she wanted to run away. And we've watched some of our friends who have left marriages, left relationships, and they've left one thorny situation and they've gone into a worse situation. Quit trying to escape. Face things head on and with the strength that God is giving you to move forward. The fourth thing I'll say is realize you can embrace the cross. You can embrace the cross. This dark, dying world will bruise you. But in spite of the bruising, Christ offers us his salvation. He offers us his redemption. He offers us his healing. Sometimes healing in this life but guaranteed healing with him forever. Remember, Jesus came to save us from our sins, not our problems. We live in a fallen world. Our goal is integrity in Christ, not physical perfection. We love physical perfection. We live in a world that demands physical perfection. You have to be perfect. That's why the plastic surgeons and the drugstores and the makeup department and the haircuts. Some of you guys, you need a haircut, bad. And all of these things. We need to be perfect. But God says, I don't want you perfect. I want you like me. I want you shaped in my image. I want you to be bearing the fruit of the Spirit, love and joy and peace and patience. And what we've learned in the last 15 months, long suffering, and not to blame everybody else, but say, no, God is giving us the strength to walk through this. Now, let me finish a verse that I read earlier for you. Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. But then he says this, but fear not, I've overcome the world. You're going to have trouble. But Jesus says, I've overcome the world. Let me give you my last point, the fifth thing that I think is important to do, and that's return to worship. Worship refocuses your life. This is a key step in your journey. Today is a day about returning to worshiping God, returning to the place where you first encountered a loving God. Do you remember the first time you encountered God? Do you remember that moment when suddenly you were in his presence and there was nothing like it ever? It was the greatest thing you had ever experienced. I want you today to enter into that moment even now. I want you to say, God, I need your presence. Even in the midst of the thorns of my life, I want this to be a turnaround moment. God, I want to reconnect with you. I want to stop the worry and start the worship. And that's what I want you to do today. Stop the worry and start the worship. God has a great future for every one of you. Let me conclude this way this morning. Jesus identifies with your difficulty. You know, on the cross, the Bible says he wore a crown of thorns. The Latin word for crown is this word. Maybe you've heard this word recently, corona. The Latin word for crown of thorns is corona. Jesus wore your corona of thorns. And this is the mystery. God is not impressed with our gold. He's not impressed with our houses. He doesn't look, God's not looking to wear your Rolex watch or your Gucci shoes. Do you know what God's looking for? He wants to wear your crown of thorns. He wants to bear your thorns with you. He's looking to walk with you, to connect with you. The gold is already his. The silver is already his. He wants you. That's right. Broken, imperfect, sinful, fearful you. That's what God's looking for today. He's calling you. Listen to his voice. I want to pray with you this morning. The Bible, Jesus says this, come all you who are labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Let's bow our heads and let's pray. Lord, as we come into your presence at the close of this service today, Lord, I pray that we would have the courage now to give you our crown of thorns, to give you all those thorns in our lives, those things that have been plaguing us and bothering us. Lord, some of us have given you our life goals. Lord, some of us have given you our life savings. And Lord, we've dedicated our families and our homes. But Lord, we've been reluctant to give you our thorns. So today, Lord, we give you our thorns so that we can remind ourselves Lord, that these thorns belong to you, not to us. Lord, it's not our suffering, it's the suffering you've already had for us. Lord, we give you this morning our physical thorns, our disabilities, our sickness, maybe, Lord, our aging. We give you our physical thorns. Lord, today we give you our emotional thorns. Lord, some of us have horrible memories, scars in our lives, wounds in our lives, but Lord, we give you those thorns now. And Lord, finally, we give you our personal thorns. Lord, those thorns that are so deep. Lord, they're so deep that no one knows about them. And Lord, we don't even want to share them with you. But Lord, we reach deep, deep into our spirit at this moment. And Lord, we share those moments with you, those deep thorns with you. And we say, God, please take this thorn and help me to live with it and to deal with it. And Lord, we ask you that throughout this week, you would continue to guide us. Lord, might our prayer be in Christ alone, we've placed our trust. Lord, that in Christ alone, we find our glory in the power of the cross. In Christ alone, that we would say that every victory, let it be said of me, our source of strength, our source of hope is in Christ alone. Lord, we celebrate the power of your resurrection today. And Lord, we thank you for that. And we pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Let me say a couple of things in closing today. First of all, I want you to remember to remember the power of the resurrection. It is our hope, folks. The death is our victory, but the resurrection is our hope. And our hope is everything. Jesus is not playing with us when he talks about the resurrection. He says, I came to give you life and to give it to you abundantly. And we have to abide in that. We have to obey that. Over the next few weeks, you're going to continually have some decisions to make. We're not out of a pandemic yet, but I want you to come out of this pandemic victorious. And some people, you have a choice. You can come out and say, I panicked. Oh, I panicked. I didn't know what to do. I panicked. Some people, all they've done through this pandemic is they just keep scrolling. They just keep scrolling. Their minds have not been fixed on the Lord. Some people have watched news nonstop, and it's confused them. It's discouraged them. It's put them in a very negative place. Some people have complained. All they do is complain. Some people are bugged by all the inconveniences. You have the choice to make. You can be panicked. You can scroll. You can watch TV. You can complain. You can get bothered by the inconvenience. Or you can say, I spent more time in God's word. I learned what it was like to have that first relationship, our first love back. I got closer to my friends. Maybe it was on Zoom. Maybe it was on the phone, but I got my family back. A lot of families have gotten their family back because they've had to. They've had to live in the same home. I've learned how to be content, how to be still. I've spent so many hours in this office and so many hours in that chair back there, just saying, Lord, I just need to be content and to be still. This is a time when we can be a blessing to our neighbors. They don't even have to know. Just go cut their grass, help them, take their garbage out, bring their garbage pails back, whatever. But most of all, this is a time when we can just spend time with Jesus. Maybe God has caused this big, great big pause in our life, this big pause in the world, so that people would wake up and say, hey, there's a God that I can love and that I can worship and who loves me. Let me bless you today with this blessing. I bless you with the truth that God is for you and not against you. May his power and wisdom be strength to you as you enter into this next week. May your efforts for his kingdom bring glory and honor to the name of Jesus, to whom we owe everything. I bless you with this truth. A new day is about to dawn. It's going to bring a new season. It's going to bring new fruit. And I bless you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you, Pastor.
Wow. Praise God. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know what, brothers and sisters? Holy Spirit is truly at work in our midst. To all of you who've been attending this this church for the last few weeks, we've been we just completed our series of study in First Peter, and we all know what the theme of First Peter is: Peter's letter of encouragement to the believers who were scattered all over the place and that going through a lot of challenges and hardship in life and persecution. And we the last time I preached, I said that. If there is Toys R Us, I would say sufferings are us. That's part of our life as a believer. And now Pastor Mark has said that thorns are us. This is who we are. This is God's way of molding us and pruning us and transforming us to the person that God wants us to be so that we can be useful agents of God, useful instruments of God for his glory. Thorns are here for our benefit. And I said also in the last preaching I preached, I said that sufferings are friend for the believers. Let's not consider it as an enemy, but sufferings are friend to all of us. And last Wednesday also, our dear sister Jasmine spoke about thorn in the flesh in 2 Corinthians 12. And it's again another encouragement to all of us that God did not remove the thorn in the flesh in Paul's life, but he just answered him, my grace is sufficient for you. The grace of God is sufficient for all of us, even as we go through this pandemic. And guess what? Last Saturday, Brother Arnel spoke about life's challenges. Life's challenges. Wow, what a powerful progression of God's message to all of us. And today, we heard from the Lord through Pastor Mark, the mystery of thorns. Praise God. I don't know about you, but I am so much encouraged by the word of God that through this pandemic, the more that I will be focusing myself on what God has for me through this pandemic. God did not allow this pandemic for no reason at all. God is not a cruel God. God is a loving God. He allowed this pandemic to happen with a great purpose for us believers and for his glory. For his glory. Let us focus on the very reason why God put us in this situation. And with that, let's give the glory to the Lord. Again, thank you, Pastor Mark. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Again, thank you all for coming. And let's just please join me in closing this gathering in a short prayer. Hallelujah, Lord God. Before we close this prayer, let's just pray for Pastor Mark and Wendy. Father God, Lord, what a wonderful time of fellowship that you have given us by sending Pastor Mark, oh God, and I know Sister Wendy is beside him, oh God, Lord. And thank you for the presence, oh God, Lord. Most of all, thank you, Holy Spirit, for your presence in their lives, oh God, as you are continuously using her as well in a Western Ontario District of Pentecostal Assemblies of Canada in energizing churches and revitalizing churches, oh God, and even encouraging churches, oh God, Lord, who needs encouragement, oh God, Lord. And Lord, we want to thank you for your Pastor Mark's life, oh God, and Wendy, oh God, Lord. Amen. And we speak continuous blessing upon them, protection after protection, oh God, Lord, even their family, their children, and their grandchildren, oh God, Lord, and whatever roles that you have placed in their life, oh God, Lord, in the PAOC Western Ontario District, oh God, Lord. And again, thank you for the message that you brought upon us, oh God, today through him. And Lord, again, this is a great, great reminder to all of us, oh God, Lord, to continuously put our faith and trust in you, oh God, Lord, that while we are still in this pandemic, oh God, which is some form of thorns in our lives, oh God, Lord, but yet, Lord, we know that through this, oh God, you will continuously be with us, continuously strengthen us, oh God, continuously use this for our benefit, oh God, Lord, and to glorify your name through this. Lord, again, thank you for today. and we give you all the glory, honor, and praise. And now to him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise God. God bless you all. Thank you again, Pastor.